Hello.
Basically our education committee. I want to thank you all for coming out tonight, especially for this wonderful occasion for our honoree here, Arva Moore Parks McCabe, who I got to meet back in 1991 as a lowly educator and operations manager at the Historical Museum of Southern Florida. Here was this legend who had helped start several institutions, who took a liking to me and said hello and wondered what was going on with me and what I wanted to do with my future. That experience changed my life forever. Arva didn't know it, but she changed my life forever. So it's appropriate that we're here to honor her and her work. Before I introduce you to the best speaker I've seen also, I want you to know that her documentary, Our Miami, The Magic City, is airing on Coral Gables Television. Actually, it aired at 3 o'clock, it'll air again at 7, and again at 10. If you haven't seen it, it's brilliant. It's how I started my day today. It made me remember why I love Miami. Because we know who the natives really are. Thank you for coming, ladies and gentlemen, without further ado. Oh, let me introduce the people who are going to talk to you about this wonderful woman today who changed our community. First of all, you've met John Allen. Arva was my mentor, and she didn't even know it. John Allen will tell you, she literally mentored him and built this place that you're sitting here today. Sitting next to him is another one of my mentors, but he should by now literally know that he's a mentor. Is Dr. Paul George, who, when I worked at, the Historical Museum of Southern Florida, took it on himself to talk to a lowly operations manager and say, let's go out, let's take a camera, and let's go shoot my next book, which we produced together. I'll never forget that. And then, last but not least, is Suzanne Graham Gibson. Family friend, I don't think, says enough about the relationship. That's what I put as a title. You really are family. And it's great that you and the rest of the family took took time out of your schedules, took money out of your pockets, and came here today to honor her. So thank you. We appreciate you. Ladies and gentlemen, without further ado, David Moore.
Because of the George Merritt controversy. And, you know, I'm a great lover of Lincoln. Grew all his life. Extraordinary human being. The three most written people about in the history of the world were Napoleon Bonaparte, Jesus Christ, and Abraham Lincoln, whom there are 17,000 books written about Lincoln. Hard to believe. Extraordinary human being. I like Lincoln because he grew all his life. But he was a man of his time, a human being of his time. He said things, including, incidentally, he said that he didn't think black and white people would be social equals for at least a century. Sadly, he was right. We've not overcome this yet. And if you'll let me say this and not get uptight and say, God, the guy's 79, what the hell would he know anymore anyway? Racism remains a great cancer of American society, and we'll never get to diminish it until we confront ourselves. So I could be the nicest white guy I've ever seen, the most progressive. But if I told you I was black, or transgender, or gay, or something else, I'm worried about this guy. I think we're all lifelong learners, or should be, and this is emblematic of this group. So I was thinking about George Merritt after the University of Miami decision. And I had read Arva's book on George Merritt, which I think is her single best book. I love the book. If you haven't read it, I think you can get it. And I went back to the book because my memory was this guy was actually pretty advanced for his time. We're talking about almost 100 years ago. And if you read her book, I think you would come away with a different impression than we have been left with in some ways in recent days. Wasn't perfect, was a man of his time, but actually had a pretty good soul and was willing to learn himself. So today is not only about history, but I hope it's personal. This is not about reading her bio or her resume. This is about what made and makes Arva special. What kind of example was she for the rest of us? And we have three pretty extraordinary panels. And we have Arva's daughter, Carrie. Where are you, Carrie? Right in the front row, right where I want you, Carrie. and I'm going to get Carrie at some point to just do a little of your own personal sense of your mom and what she meant to you. What you think she might need to us if you would at some point. John Allen, I admire all three of these people deeply. So you've got John Allen, and you've got Paul George, and you've got a person whose name was truncated in the introduction.
I have four names.
Because she had one more name. And her very first name. Arva, and it should not be forgotten. We may call her Susanna, but it's Arva Susanna Graham Gibson. And her father and mother are two of the best people I've ever known. Well, we know mostly about Bob Graham, the senator, the governor, distinguished Floridian, distinguished American. What we know less about is Adele Graham. Now, those of you who really know her, she's the best politician in the whole family. Quite extraordinary. She does better at schmoozing than most people in any crowd that I've ever been in. And she's gracious and lovely and special. You come from a heck of a heritage.
I think she's watching. Where's the camera?
that right here.
Well, this is good. So, Sutan, why don't we start with you? Your mother and Arva Parks are stunningly close. So how close were they? And how far back does this go?
I can honestly say that they spoke every single day to the last day of August 5th.
And started when?
Started in the third grade when I was born. And it started in Miami Shores. They both, their houses backed up to each other's, and they started going to school together. And my mom was their only child, and Arva is like her sister, and Harry and I are like sisters from being raised together with Arva and Adele.
So just think about this all those years back, decade upon decade. And Paul, do I remember that you grew up somewhere near there, right?
I grew up about a block and a half away from Arva's house. In fact, in one of my books, A Little Man, I have a photograph of her on Halloween night, obviously dressed up in costume, getting ready to trick-or-treat in the very same neighborhood that I was trick-or-treating in. And what's also sort of sadly ironic is that she passed away four blocks away from my house of today. We're in the Riverside neighborhood that moved to Shenandoah. She did the same thing over a long progression of time.
She loved this community and took enormous pride in this community. And she wasn't just focused on the past, but the present and the future. Talk about that a bit.
Well, that was kind of the amazing thing about her. I guess in many ways, at least up until modern times, a typical historian probably taught at the college level and kind of burrowed into the library and spent her his time just researching primary source material, whatever else, and that was probably the extent of it. But she was a real community historian. Besides being a very serious researcher using primary source material, she also was in the community. In fact, we got a great anecdote. I got a call from her one night, and this relates to John's scene too. I was watching the Super Bowl, not too far from here, with a good buddy and a bunch of other friends, and it was a great game. It was about, I don't know how long ago, about 10 years ago. And she calls me, and I took the call, and she says, what do you think about me being the sort of the temporary head of this fledgling Coral Gables History Museum? I said, I think it's a great idea, but I'm in the middle of the Super Bowl, can we talk about it tomorrow? She was probably the only person in Miami not watching the game. But that was her intensity about doing things. And she assumed it. Like, she assumed the leadership of the Coral Gables Historic Preservation Board when they created that 40 plus years ago. Her activism at the University of Miami as a very influential board member. It just goes on and on and on. Tremendous involvement. And it was always, trying to not only help the community, but give people a sense of place, respect for the area, feeling about how special the area was. I can remember one time I was authoring a book, actually editing a book. I had some articles in it on Florida history, and so I went out through the state and tried to recruit different historians for different areas of the state's history. And I said, would you mind just maybe, contributing a chapter or maybe on some element of Florida? And she said, frankly, my main concern is Miami. I'd rather just stay with that. And that was just the way it was. There was so much here, and she understood that to focus on. She was probably also the first historian I know dealing with Miami history that used the National Archives. And so some of her primary source material, this is kind of a fancy term historians use. You get it your first day of graduate school. She went to the National Archives and researched that. And in the latest iteration of Tequesta, we published her article, Miami in 1876. And so why did we choose that over all the hundreds of articles? I chose it because of the primary source material that she used in there, which, was like a gold mine we hadn't seen before. And so she gave us a look at an area and an era we never knew about before. So, those are some of the things. We shared the same kindergarten teacher 4 or 5 years apart, but didn't know each other. I first met her when I came back down from Florida State. It was in the mid-70s. I was working on my doctorate, and she and Thelma Peters. Thelma Peters was a historian who preceded her as a historian, a very dynamic person, a wonderful historian. In fact, we've had so few historians until modern times, and now we got a lot of history being written in this community. But we had Lemon City Elementary in the late 19th, early 20th century. She died in 1923. She was teaching Miami history to elementary school kids, probably in an informal way. And then we had Thelma Peters. We had Helen Muir, who wrote a book, Miami, USA. She researched and wrote the book in 9 months. And that was in 1953. And then we had Thelma and Arva. And then, you know, then more and more people began to embrace this topic, and in part because people like Thelma and Arva popularized it.
So, John, your first meeting with her, you weren't the coolest guy running around, right?
No, to say the least. I mean, well, first of all, if I had to describe Arva in two words, it would be as a steel magnolia. It, to me, she was always charming, witty, gracious, all those fine attributes and many more. But to get back to what you're asking me, I had been a fan of hers for years, but I had never had the pleasure of meeting her. I've been reading her works since the 1970s. In about 1981, 1982, right around that time, we were first getting involved too, she spoke at a luncheon at the Hyatt. And I was in complete awe. You know, here I am, a voracious reader, a wannabe historian, and here is Arva Moore Parks talking. And I was very young, and we're standing outside after the luncheon, waiting for our cars. And by nature, I'm not really outgoing, just walk up to a stranger or a celebrity and talk to them, but I was dying to continue this conversation. So, I couldn't think of anything to ask for, ask her about, so I plucked up the courage, I have no idea where it came from, to introduce myself, like she, you know, would care, tell her that I was a huge fan and how much I enjoyed and admired her work. But one thing I didn't know, I told her, was, and in retrospect, this was such a lame question, where was George Merritt Barry? Is that the most ridiculous question you've ever heard? And
this was your deep intellectual
self. This was my deep intellectual self coming out, right? But the amazing thing is that she, of course, told me, Woodlawn. And after a couple of minutes, we kept the conversation going. She suggested we step back inside the hotel and talk. And we talked in the lobby for over an hour. And she became not only an instant friend, but a mentor to me, a true mentor, and I've had very few in my life, for over 25 years, starting that very day. My respect and admiration did nothing but increase over those many years, and especially after I was really involved with Arva with the creation of the museum. No matter how busy she was, she always took time to talk to me, as she did to just about everyone, and she always made me feel, when she was talking to me, that I was the most important person in the room.
Arva Suzanne. She had a special interest in women, the empowerment of women, letting them have a chance to have a spotlight. Talk about that, maybe talk about some of the people that she particularly admired.
Absolutely. She, I know, felt very strongly that the story of the founding women of Miami needed to be one that was known and appreciated. And she worked very tirelessly to have the Julia Tuttle statue, which is now in the park, the Bicentennial Park. And she flew to LA several times to work with the sculptress to make sure that the story of the dress was the story of Miami. And she really labeled the mother of Miami for Julia Tuttle, which, and then she also made sure that everybody knows that she's one of the only founding female of a city in the country. I think I'm correct about that. She also really was an advocate for children of this city and for the underprivileged of this city, and worked also in a lot of areas that, along with history, preservation, and education. And she cared so much about everyone. I think she really was almost the mentor of our modern day Miami. And I'm so enthusiastic about Miami and proud to be from Miami. And she was always embracing of the changes of Miami and took it as it came and figured it out and went to work. And one of my stories that actually also involves my mom, is that they were discussing something around tearing down the beautiful historic theater at their high school, Edison High School, and they met with the principal, and the principal said, well, you care about, you know, if you care about this architecture, what about the students that come through these halls? And so what did Arva do? She got to work, and she called my mom, and they jumped into a program which is called the Edison Linkage, I believe, and what we did with Carrie, we went down to Haiti, and we collected street art, and then we came back with the art, and it was framed, and we had an auction, and the funds from the auction went to tutor the incoming Haitian students. And so she was never intimidated to jump in there and do what needed to be done, not just for the four walls, but for the heartbeats that live within those four walls.
So we had some Haitian art at home that came directly from going there. It went on for a number of years, right?
Yes, it did.
And Carrie, you would go there with your mom and with Adele. Talk about that.
Well, it was
can you
fantastic.
All hear it back there? Okay. The points are great.
The artwork that we purchased and that we resold, and we did very well. It was very successful. I think it also was for the books, for the kids and the books also. And I have my own collection. I fell in love with Haitian art. And we all have, as we all have, and I have it, I guess about 5 or 6 pieces. I have a whole Haitian room in my house.
Woo-hoo! I did too.
So
we fell in love with the people in Haiti and just every bit of it. The ironworks and all of it. My kids can attest to it.
Yeah, that's fantastic. John, she was very involved in helping to save the billboard, right? Talk about that.
Well, she absolutely was, along with Dorothy Thompson, one of our former mayors, the two of them were instrumental in doing that. And if I was asked to name her two greatest achievements, I would say it was her role in saving the Biltmore from destruction and her incomparable biography of George Merritt. But I'm looking at a friend of mine, and it reminds me of a story, if I can digress a moment.
If it's good, you can.
I think it's pretty good. Okay? When I was thinking about all of this, I thought of a very humorous, kind of a joke or a jokeette. My friend Alan Morris relayed to me some 20 years ago now. You had hurt your back, if you remember. And you asked me, how can you tell a true Southern gentleman, in this case, a true Southern gentlewoman? And I rose to the bait, fool that I was, and asked, how? And he goes, because, in his deadpan answer, a true Southern gentleman can tell you to go to Hades, and you know you'll enjoy the trip. And that was how Arva was. And she was like that when she was fighting to save the Biltmore. She was like that when she was writing the Merritt.
So she was tough as well as
she read. She wore velvet gloves over a fist of steel. Mm-hmm. But she never made you feel stupid. She never dismissed your thoughts. She listened to them. She might not disagree with them, and if she didn't, she wouldn't take long for her to tell you so. But it was always done in a friendly, professional manner because she cared what you thought.
On that note, I'm sure this gathering is so important for so many of us, because during this time it's been so hard. We've lost Arva, and we haven't been able to be together and share stories and celebrate all that she means to so many people. And I've been overwhelmed by the response of her passing, how many people really just adored her and appreciative of her. And I had the honor of serving for a few years on the Date Heritage Trust Board, and I know we have Becky and Chris are here. And I know everybody in this room, her voice is in my head all of the time. She has such a distinctive tone of voice, and she would say, it is important. It is important. And no matter 9 to 1, she was, it is important because of X, and she really stood her ground, and she believed what she believed in wholeheartedly.
was always really proud of Miami, despite its flaws. Yeah. Maybe talk about that and her sense of the future as well as the past.
Well, she just touched this great pride in the city, and we would talk about the old Riverside neighborhood and how special it was. I remember when she remarked to me one time that when they moved to Jacksonville, I guess her father, who was an attorney, prospered after the war, World War II, so they moved to Jacksonville, excuse me, out to Miami Shore. She said, I felt like I was out in Jacksonville. I wanted to be right in the core of Miami. And I think that was her sense. And so she just made it a point to research and write about so many different elements of Miami as well as neighborhoods. Her master's thesis was on Coconut Grove. Her great study of George Maragon, Coral Gables, as well as the rest of Greater Miami. I mean, just one thing after another. It was always that sense of place. And she took a lot of time to speak in front of Rotary clubs, garden clubs, not concerned about being compensated for it because she wanted to get that message across that this was a special place. When she did Miami the Magic City, I think it was first completed in 1979 or something. Really late, 77, that was the way she thought using this media that was becoming increasingly more important to get that message out about how special this place was. It's interesting because there's kind of a yin and yang thing here. Howard Kleinberg was a very good friend of hers, and they worked together at different things. And Howard, just by nature, is a cynic. And she would talk about the magic city, he would talk about the tragic city. And they go back and forth on this. She would invariably win.
She went.
Mm-hmm. Invariably, she would win that.
Miami as well, right?
Pardon me?
But in fact,
he really loved Miami a lot. He came down from New York, and he spent his first year in Dania. Before they called it Dania Beach, and then he moved to Miami. He just found his place down here. But that was just Howard's nature, you know, to be that way, just to be a contrarian. But she won all those battles very easily.
But she did.
Always with grace, yeah.
That was a joke. I said, well, it's actually true. They should have the St. John's paint suit named the Arva because she ruled the world with her beauty and her grace, and she always had on a St. John's paint suit, red, purple, or like a beautiful blue. Yes. Peacock blue.
So this went to the university before, I think, your minor was history, was it not?
Yes, go Gators.
Yeah.
And that's where my parents are now. They're living in Gainesville. They send their love to everyone in this room and watching. They wish they could be here, but they're here in spirit.
So you're now working on a project involved in history, right? In Miami. Talk about what you're doing now.
Well, funny, when I have triplets and I was thinking, okay, now that I'm an empty nester, what do I want to do? What can I feel really passionate about? And I said, I don't know why, but I just really love Miami. It's probably in my DNA. And so I came down to take Dr. Paul George's retirement class. Turned out, no, not a real retirement, but. And so I would fly back and forth from Washington, D.C. to take his class at Miami-Dade. And I met so many interesting people and just got very inspired by downtown and wanting the message of downtown to always be part of our story. So I'm getting ready to help with the 125th birthday of Miami, which is July 28th. And lo and behold, where do I go? The downtown library. And who's sitting next to me? Dr. Paul George. We're in the Carols researching together. But what I'm working on is a teachable moment that I see with the 125th. There's going to be a really cool, hopefully, LED show up on the old courthouse. And it's going to be, you know, a lot of graphics and a lot of animation. But I said, flamingos are cute, flowers are cute, but what about the story of Miami? And all eyes are going to be watching this. So I've been working on the content of the history, especially focusing on the downtown area for the 125th, which is July 28th, so mark your calendar. And they're also renaming the auditorium at the main library, the Arva Parks McCabe Auditorium. And
nice.
We're working on it. We're hoping maybe over that weekend we can have the ribbon cutting of the newly named auditorium.
Any of you got any sense of what she would say about all the building that's going on here now? In 30 plus years, I've never seen anything like it in Coral Gables, in Miami, all over. What would Arva be mumbling about?
Actually, as she embraced the change. She found a way to make it part of our story and story of arrivals and acceptance, and just always really found it as part of the next chapter. And I think I read recently that she stated that she really wanted her legacy to be, by knowing history of Miami, we can have a better future. And trying to tie what we know is going to happen and what our story has always been, and making it part of our ever-evolving community and skyline and lives. And we all are so honored to, lucky and fortunate to live in this beautiful city.
Paul, you have a doctorate from FSU.
That other school in Florida.
You couldn't have been to Florida, not a big deal. So, one of my senses is, but maybe it's unfair, is that lots of people don't know anything about history. What's your own pain in your own soul about people knowing heritage, history, where we came from, America, Miami, etc.?
It's painful, really is, Dave. I think that the one class that made me so happy was the one Suzanne was in, but going back to the 80s when I started teaching it, because Miami South Florida history, and sometimes also Florida history, because the people in there not only knew history, but wanted to learn more about it. But when you get into a normal class of world history or American history, it was really a challenge just to keep the kids alert. You know, a lot of times eyes closed, and once the cell phones came, once the smartphones came, forget it. You know, they were into that thing while you were lecturing. It's really been difficult. But one of the ways in which I guess I've been lucky and been able to drive some pleasure out of the sermon has been the tours. Because people who will sign up for the tours and take the expense of taking a tour obviously have a step ahead of most people, and they ask a lot of questions, and that's been great. In fact, we've had some really interesting tour goers over the years. I had a man that I shared the microphone with for about 10 minutes one night on a river tour, your fabulous father, and he spoke about the Everglades in such an amazing way. And I said, you know, Senator Graham, at that point in his early 80s, has such an interest in this. You know, why can't all of us kind of follow this example? You know, it doesn't take much. You pick up a book and you read. And David and I discuss books forever. He's about 1,000 books ahead of me in terms of reading books. His first question usually is, Paul, what are you reading now? So I try to load up on things, but he's always ahead of me. How about the Lincoln books you bought recently, right? You were mentioning to me, Dave, the Lincoln acquisitions?
Well, I've always loved Lincoln because he grew all his life. And so it's way late in life to be buying anything. But I bought a first edition, high quality, Abraham Lincoln, A History by Nicolay and Hay, who Lincoln called my boys. They were his private secretaries. One of them became quite wealthy. The other was Teddy Roosevelt, Secretary of State. And this isn't what the subject is supposed to be today, but Lincoln is assassinated. He is assassinated on Good Friday, adding to the martyrdom of all of this. And we had never had a president assassinated before. 750,000 Americans have been killed in the Civil War. So the country had gone through extraordinary pain. And Robert Todd Lincoln did not love the media, and I have understated it very significantly. Never cooperated with anyone until in the 1880s he cooperated with Nicolay and Hay and wrote this 10-volume set of books that is the foundation of all of the legitimate history. So I don't think there's much more exciting than learning all your life and what was Arva Parks about. She was an extraordinary researcher, right? This is a person who somebody talked about here, whoever has the best grasp of it, talk about the George Merrick book, which is a masterpiece in detective work, right? So John, can you tell us about that, or Paul, one of the two of you?
Just for a second, I'll give it to John. That book was about 20 years in the making. And to show you the extraordinary effort that she put into that book, beginning, I think, in the late 90s, and it came out about 5 years ago. So that kind of speaks for her tenacity when it came to stick-to-itness, research, and never stopping. In other words, what delayed it in part was she continued to find new things, letters, and spoke to people like one American, but John, I'll give it to you.
No, when it came to that book, as I said, I think that's one of the two greatest things that Miami owes her a debt for, forever. She went down so many rabbit holes that I know about, I know so many I didn't know about, to get to the truth. And at the end of some of those rabbit holes, you actually find a golden nugget. I can attest to that personally. And it added to the weight and the gravitas of the book. But she never deviated from making it interesting. And if it's not interesting and no one's going to read it, it'll be praised by academics like myself or Arva and Arva Suzanne, but it's not going to sell. This book is amazing. I have read it three times since it's come out from cover to cover, and I pick up something different every time. And I've been here with her in the museum a year before she died, while she was still verifying facts on a book that had already been published, but she wanted to make sure that she had it.
Carrie, what was it like growing up?
Well, with my two brothers, it was, they were younger than I was, and we were all adopted.
My mother had been very active in Children's Home Society, had she not?
Yes, very much so. And we learned by osmosis. I mean, we just all connected so well. And, you know, we were just meant to be. And we always, some people would say, make fun of us maybe, that we were adopted. And well, she would always say, well, you were chosen. You know, some people might have had those kids, but you know, you were chosen to be my child. And she would tell me, we spoke every day on the phone, and she would say always, you know how much I love you. You know how much I love you. And I said, yeah, I know, Mom, I know. You know.
So you led a life as a ceramicist, master cook, et cetera. She gave you room to do some other things, right?
Yes, she'd go with it. You know, she loved my artwork. I would not say, I mean, I tried. People do love it, but, you know, she did. She really did love it. And she would just say, go for it. And her motto song was, Helen Reddy. You know, if I have to, I can do anything. I'm strong. I'm invincible. You know, I'm a woman. And, you know, that's like our cheer song. And
so we know her as a storyteller. She tells stories to you?
Well, there was one, which I wish my brother Greg was here, because he was there when it happened. And they went to one of their trips in Singapore, Thailand. And you've probably heard the story, with the golden domes and everything, and the green, and all the temples there are beautiful, and there's so many of them. And all the temples that she told my brother, and, you know, when they were talking about, when you walk into the beautiful temples, that there's an auspicious spot, and you have to, you know, see if you can find it. And my brother Greg was, you know, there he is, trying to find the auspicious spot. And my mother goes off, and she's, you know, doing her own thing, and trying to look up and down and record, you know, how she was. Look up, she always would say, and we toured everywhere. And they were walking up in this temple, up along, you know, long stairwell. And there was a man, a monk, that was following, you know, a little close behind. And they went all the way to the top, and they sat down on a bench, you know, just to get a rest. And, you know, she was making small talk with this monk. And she said to him, you know, trying to talk, and, oh, have you ever been to the United States? And he says, well, I have once, but there's no place like home. And it just, you know, that's how she felt about Miami. Mm-hmm. And she loved her beloved city so much. Oh, and that was all about save this, and we have to go up, and we have to do this, and where
are you going now, Mom? And, you know,
you always
cigars, smoke, and, you know, the Timberlands.
Terry, you have other members of your family here. Introduce them.
This is my son, Will, Kara, my daughter, Alex, Kara, and my partner, Brian Sharon.
So how about the grandchildren saying something?
You want to say something?
I mean, there's so much to say.
You all hear back there?
So much. I lived with Arva for a few summers too, and it was, I mean, let me tell you, she's a tough cookie to live with. I mean, also,
this is the
so
like, yeah,
I know.
Okay,
God, if I snuck out, she would know everything. But I mean, I loved her to death. She was amazing. And I mean, I miss her every day. But there's no doubt she loved me.
That's wonderful. And loved you?
Yes, she loved family and Christmas. Mm-hmm.
She loved Christmas?
Oh, she loved Christmas.
How'd she celebrate Christmas?
Oh, I mean, she made my brother and I sit at the top of the stairwell, I think, until like
every single year.
I mean, we were what?
Her, my little sister, all three of us.
28 years old.
Still
the same.
20 years of us, you know, waiting.
Yeah, she made us sit at the top of the stairwell and say, come down. Come down to the tree.
So let me do this. Momentarily, I'm going to ask people out there, as it were, what thoughts or questions they have. Arva, what didn't we cover, Arva Suzanne, that we should have said about our friend Arva?
Well, I want to echo how much she loved her children. They were first and foremost. And she had a career. She started her historical career, kind of her second career. First, she was a teacher. And I think I have this right that she was teaching, and there was a posting for a free class at UN, and maybe you actually got some stipend if you went back to school in the summer as a teacher to learn a little bit about history, and that's what started her whole second life of passion around history. I just love how much she reinvented herself all the time, and she really is a role model for modern life of what is possible if you love something. Even it wholeheartedly, that you can make anything happen. And I feel like she touched lives that she, I hope she knows. I know she's watching right now. And she not only touched lives, she touched the city and left a mark. And I think people appreciate Miami more because of the work of Dr. Paul George and Arva and making it a story that is something everybody can kind of hold on to, and that's the mark that I'm so proud to be associated with, and just my mom and she's, their friendship is one of those very, very special friendships that you have one friend like that in their life, they're a very, very lucky person.
Beautiful.
And Arva had so many friends, and thank you all for coming, and from my whole family, we really appreciate everybody's love and caring for during this challenging time that it's been. And I know this feels really good for me to have this moment. It's not seen carry and more than that. So it's nice for all of us to be in. I'm so honored to be with this panel too. I'm kind of pinching myself that this is all happening right now.
Well, David, I know someone lighter that your thing was so beautiful, but mine's a little bit lighter. She asked me a couple Christmases to bring over my two sons, and they were so rowdy. The main of her grandchildren and all, they were so rowdy, I refrained from it. And so I had this sort of pang of guilt. And after the second Christmas, when we didn't show up, I called them and I said, I don't know if it was by January 2nd, so I said, no, I'm sorry, she was really uptight. I'm actually so distraught. I thought we were going to take down this trip and went over. So I said, is there any chance to come by? She said, I'm sorry, they've all gone back to New York. And that was it, which is great. But a couple of things to remember about her. She saved a lot of things, one of which was the Sears Tower, which is so important. I'm such a beacon of mine in the early 1929. And the second thing that's interesting is that, and Arva Suzanne brought this up, but the 125th, the 100th was sensational. And you, of course, were the Herald at that time, so you know what it was like. And we had a lot of great events in 95, 96.
important was she was able, working with the city commission and all, to sort of recreate the Royal Palm Hotel. We had dinner there. Were you there, David? That was sensational. And I don't think I got served until about midnight. My wife and I had to go back and pick up the children from the babysitter. We missed the dinner, but I'll tell you, the cocktail hour was kind of that. The cocktail hour did. But she was the moving force behind that. And there were probably hundreds of people there in costume at that point.
I remember a great catalog of the evening, brochure.
Yeah,
you must have been in this.
There was some place, place, right? It was so very special. It really was. So I mean, there were so many, you know, small things and big things that she did. She cataloged so much in a lifetime. And you were mentioning University of Miami. I think you were. She met her youth when she met Carlton's about it. It was a long time story. University of Miami, very gentleman, nice man who came from Georgia, but once he got down to the late 30s, which was right here in his history, and she became his, he became her muse. And that's really rooted in the Miami history, which Carlton
loved. I think the thing that, you know, sticks most in my mind with Arva is that when she set out to prove something, she was relentless and determined, and discussions with her could be, let's say, animated at times, but you could be in complete disagreement with her, and she would still weigh it against her own opinion. And as the doyenne of Miami history, we'll probably never see the likes of her again, she was rarely, if ever, wrong. But you never felt that she was using her knowledge in anything but a professional and kind manner. And she took Miami and its storied history, most of which, with all due respect to Paul George, who knows this true, had gone unreported and so much. And it was Paul and Arva that created a sense of history for Miami. And it's story history to her heart, and she took it seriously. And in my mind, her loss will always be felt by those of us who know and loved her, knew and loved her, excuse my language. And Miami will, you know, pretty much forever be in her debt. And I hope she's not for that. I know she never will be by me.
Becky, would you talk about your own perspective on Arva, please?
Oh, I would be just delighted on two things that haven't been emphasized, I think, yet. One, of course, her movie with Junior Lee, that was, I had just moved here in 78, and her movie, Our Miami and Magic City, really introduced me to Miami's history, and we had a fabulous opening reception with the Grahams. At Dustin in 1980, and that was just, she had that whole Dustin Auditorium was so full to overflowing. It was the most fabulous event. And actually, the Junior League is now naming its archives in memory of Arva. But the other aspect I wanted to mention was her role internationally in the International Women's Forum, because she, proposed me and got me in, I think, in 1998, saying this is something you must do because you meet incredible women from around the world, and they have annual conferences in Hong Kong and Jerusalem or Tel Aviv or all around the world. And she and Arva McCabe went to, I don't know how many of those conferences, and she had friends, literally, on every continent. And she was so proud of Miami, and she wrote, I think we had three major international conferences in Miami. The latest she and I worked on was in 2018, I believe it was, just recently, not seems recently. But just from an international viewpoint, she really had a finger out there too. Mm-hmm. So I was just, I'm remarkable.
Thank you, Becky. Are there people that have questions or observations? Alan, you've been around a long time. Doesn't mean you're old, Alan, but you've been around a long time. What What's your own sense?
I know that Arva has inspired me in so many different ways for over 25 years. Every building that I have designed for Coral Gables, I hired Arva to advise me on the historical integrity of what she knew George Merrick's passion was. And we would spend hours talking about, and we would get both so excited about designing things that would be great for Coral Gables. And that's a controversial thing, because building buildings in Coral Gables is a controversial thing, and has been for a long time. George Merrick faced it himself, great controversy, when he was building things in Coral Gables, after he created, after the government was created. But one of the things that I found when I read her book, just speaking as a real estate person, as I read her book on George Merrick's life, there were a couple of times when I got tears in my eyes reading what she described George Merrick went through at different times, the fear and the pressure and the stress of wanting to create something so great in Coral Gables, and never knowing how it would come out and if it would work out and how the story would end. And I said, I relate to this guy. I relate to George Merrick. Building out Hamlet Towers sent me to the hospital with a diagnosis of a brain tumor, which it turns out I didn't have. It was just the stress of going through it and creating it. And George Merrick went through that, and Arva describes that so beautifully in her book that it was just, it was powerful. But, everyone has wonderful stories about Arva, and I'm just grateful for all the ways that she's touched my life and my profession, my career. So,
Rhonda and Kirk, what can you tell us about making sure we keep history and heritage in this community?
I'm Kirk Fernandez. I grew up here at Coral Gables since 62. I actually know Carrie from the youth center. Back in the day, I coached Robbie. And I coached everybody, including Jeanette and my son. What Arva did in my life was that she unlocked a door that was locked for so many years that had a hidden treasure behind it. And that locked door was keeping my generation from connecting to the generation before us. And without connecting with that, the early years, it's hard to guide our community forward. And she unlocked that door. And I was in awe of the tangible history, the treasure. She made it real. It's almost as if we all time travel to another place in time. She made it real for us. Like you said, history, like typical textbooks or phone books, academics would look at it, but you wanted to connect with the community, wanted to connect. And she did that. And when I heard of her passing, I can honestly say, other than family and very close friends, I was seriously heartbroken. Because it was like if you discovered something special, and all of a sudden, it got away from you. Because I wanted to learn so much more, and I figured there was so much more to tell, and so many more stories to give. That her passing was a heartbreak for, I'm sure, a lot of people, but especially for our community. So my actual question for the panel is, did you see her work bridge the gap and open the eyes of generations, later generations, that perhaps would never have connected with our city in the way that they have, thanks to her work?
Yeah, I think that was one of her greatest contributions to bring people, myself included, from an earlier point through the present to give us appreciation of where we were and where we're going. And that's really one of the great things that a historian can contribute. I think she did a great job doing that.
Kirk, I can tell you this. We have a 20-year-old that works the front desk. And when I'm slow at the museum is that we're coming out of this pandemic, and I have him do research for me. And he had never heard of George Merrick, which is not a sin. I mean, he's 20 years old. But he's lived in the Gables almost all his life. He has borrowed my second copy of George Merrick, because my first copy no one is allowed to touch. It's assigned by Arva, and it's locked up, and God forbid the person that takes it. But I have a second copy, and I lent it to him. He has read it, and this is not a reader. At the age of 20, he has read it twice, and it has opened his eyes to where he lives. Mm-hmm. So that's not empirical data, but, I mean, he certainly can't be an anomaly, you know? So.
Rhonda, you want to say something?
Just briefly, I never had the opportunity of meeting Mar, but I did have the opportunity of meeting the father.
Somebody back there. Yes, ma'am.
Well, I want to share a story about Arva. So a couple of years ago, I was working with...
Introduce yourself.
Oh, I'm Judy Morris.
Who doesn't know
Judy? Alan's wife, my mother, is Dorothy Thompson. So a couple of years ago, I met a PBS producer, Lorena Turner, and she had just done Graceful Voices, and it was such a wonderful video. We became friends, and we decided that we'd like to do a documentary about George Merrick, and I thought, well, we better meet with Arva. And so we met with Arva right next door at Books and Books, started talking about our idea, and I said, we really want to bring George to life, and so we'd like to use dramatic recreations, reenactments. She goes, oh, no, don't do that. No dramatic recreations. And I said, well, she goes, no actor can play George Merrick. And I said, well, I don't mean like an actor coming in and actually being George Merrick, but we can show the side of a face or the hands or something. No. She goes, I have so many still shots, and still shots with music is all you need. And then she began to tell us all about George Merrick and how she felt with the story she told. And afterwards, after she left, Lorena said, she's in love with George Merrick. And I said, yeah, I think she is in love with George Merrick. So she's also really protective of the story. Mm-hmm. And Lauren said, yes, she is. She said, you know, I'm a little nervous. And I said, okay. And she goes, let's continue talking about this, but I need to go rethink this. And she left, and like that was her interest was gone from doing the documentary because Arva was so passionate that day about George Merrick and how the story should be told. And what she really was showing us was how history is so important and to preserve it the right way and accurately. Mm-hmm. And she just wanted to be sure of that. And along with what we said about, like Kirk said, you feel like something was taken from you. I took it for granted that she was going to be around a long time. And I was letting Lorena go her own way, and I was going to come back to it. And I actually, Arva loved the color purple, right? And she was wearing purple. And so I had been on a vacation, and I bought these earrings that had purple stones, and I was going to give them to Kurt. I still have them. And I thought, I'm going to meet with her again. Mm-hmm. And when I heard the news, I cried. We have lost such a treasure in our hearts.
That's very good. Don, Mr. Mayor?
Yeah, I just want to humanize this a little bit. I could talk like Becky for hours about our and but several things that haven't been said that you ought to know. That number one is that some years ago, when the children were young, they moved across the golf course from us in one of the most historic homes in Coral Gables. So that's important to understand that her relationship with Coral Gables does not only because of academic research, but because of her life in a home secondly, as a human thing, that she and Jeanette and the PTA at Carver worked on the integration of Carver.
Mm.
I think that's a very important aspect beyond historic preservation, beyond history. Actively work together to bring in a whole new environment to our community and to our education system. And finally, what you all didn't know, besides Coral Gables, is that until the day she died, Arv and I served on the University of Florida's Historic Preservation Board for St. Augustine. And we miss her greatly there, too. She shared a commitment not only to Coral Gables, but to Florida, and she served there. So she served as a good gator. So.
Yes, sir.
I was going to say, she wasn't my hurricane as well. That's the one.
Say it again.
The current controversy.
I'm voting possibly dispatched from the city board. How do you think Arva would feel about that? Statue in front of city hall. What do you think Arva would say?
Thanks for the softball, Patrick.
What did you on the spot, sir?
I think she would disagree entirely and 100% against that. And for what it's worth, I would agree with her. You can't rewrite history. And a lot of what has been said has been incorrect or misconstrued. And that's really all I have to say about it, except I think she would be tying herself to the statue and saying, take me with her. Take me with him. Am I right, Gary?
Yes, completely.
Thank you.
Paul, what do you say?
Well, it's kind of like what you said earlier, how people evolve. You got to look at the times. You got to dig deeper. There have been things that have been uncovered about Merrick that put a much more positive light on some of the charges that we made against him in terms of, I don't know if it was racism, but acceptance of the Jim Crow in Miami in that era. And she was the preeminent champion of George Merrick, and she would have dug as much as she had to prove that he was probably more progressive than most Miamians of that era in terms of race. And I've seen quotes on him also that seem to be a lot more progressive on race than the norm at that time. So I think she would have not only championed him, but she would have made really compelling arguments based on documentary evidence that he was struggling with it like everybody was, and he was out there, he was ahead of people, I think.
I agree with what's been said, and Carrie and I were in communication all the time, and we were very troubled by the recent articles and feel that it's a difficult situation, but again, she would probably be out there finding the collateral that would be needed to protect her man, George, and she probably put it in a way that people could understand it. And that's one thing I really miss about Arva's touch, is that she would find a story and layer it into a point that makes people kind of understand different perspectives. And again, it's a different time, it's a different place, but Miami's always evolving, and a way to fix it so that it could be appreciated and respected on both sides of this topic. But I know that she cared very much herself for children, as what was mentioned. I remember, I think they used to carpool, didn't they? They started their own carpool, the Payne's family, to help integrate and bring children into the schools. They'd get up at 5 o'clock in the morning and go to neighborhoods and drive children in to integrate the schools. And she was a doer. And I feel like she would jump into this subject and really try to make it into a teachable moment.
Yeah, I think that might be one of the only times the velvet gloves would come off the stick. But I can tell you this, I took it on myself to make sure that entire copies of these articles that were taken out of context when you only look at one paragraph, arguably, and the fact that people don't realize that things like segregation were the law back then. You couldn't violate the law. I don't think Arva would even advocate that George Merrick should have violated the law. So you have to look at those things in a perspective that's a little different than we look at it now, because it is what it is. But I know Arva would be nuts without being disrespectful. Yes, sir.
My name is Elijah Robertson. I came to Miami back in 1999, a week later, Hurricane Lily or something. Mm-hmm. And I didn't have any clients at the time. I'm printing that. I do a lot of book printing. And I was lucky enough to run into Arva. I don't believe in luck, actually. Destiny. She was the first client. I came knocking on the door. Regina, her secretary, talked to me and said, we'll have time and I'm pretty busy. I came back again and she chased me out again and said, Gina. Finally, I came back a third time and said to her, look, just, I'm going to bring some quotes. You're not the door. Just please look at them. She goes, you know what? You're so persistent. Just I'll make an appointment for you. And that was my lucky day. I came in. Met Arva, and straight up lady, a lot of respect, and she gave me an opportunity to bid on the Biltmore Hotel book. And I came back with a price about a week or so later. I met Mr. McCabe. He was the one having the business at the time, and he was sitting there on his desk, and he had me sit in the chair, and I gave him the price. He looked down at the sheet. I swear, he almost fell over. And then got his composure back and he said, oh, the price is okay. I gave the job away. We all did good. I mean, I'm glad he was happy. But after that, it was history. Arva became my friend. And what I would say, my reputation, it's a reputation of mine. You got to do a good job. And it's not. And of course, I upheld that. Strong like that. And I respected her and became friends and she opened up to me. As a matter of fact, she mentioned something to me about Merrick, having a sort of romantic tie with him. Like, no, I gotta learn. That's one of the books I didn't do for her. I did most of the books. When she needed a good job done, of course, always, she came to me. And of course, I tried hard. Mm-hmm. I regret that I did not know her more. She was somebody real special. And we looked at each other in the eye. And she was a great businesswoman. It was always business. But it was good. And she invited us to come to her house always at Christmas time. And we'd get together. And she was my champion in the sense that she'd always tell her friends about me. I got into the community. I live in Brickell now. I'm proud of being in Miami. When I see the river, I realize the South is not so good. The North is not so good. The South is one of the religious people and all of that. And Miami being water and all that. And I think about the history. And I go, man, you know what? I want to make history too. So that's something that Arva did for me. I appreciate that.
So you get the last.
My name is Laura Pincus Seacoff, and I worked with Arva when I finished my master's degree at UN and worked for about 10 or 15 years, but I think it was more than that, right, Gary? And Arva collected people.
Mm.
And I think I was fortunate to be somebody she collected. You know, she sort of launched my adulthood in so many deeply personal and substantial ways. And, you know, we bonded because she was my boss for a long time. But she was my mentor, but I don't think mentor goes that way. I'm sort of a political junkie, and she is. We would watch the conventions together because that's like a very weird thing to do, but we were probably the only two people who would actually, you know, watch the speeches, and you know, I would call her in the middle of the speech, and I'd be like, oh, wow, you know, what do you think of this one or that one, and just, you know, odd little tidbits that we would share. And I think that her sense of you were never too small for her.
Mm.
And that's a really impressive thing to say about a human being. It didn't really matter who you were, that, you know, she lifted you. And when you think about the people in your life who impact you, if you have someone who you can say enriched your life by their very existence every single day, that's what Arva was like. And, you know, things I learned from her to always return a call. You know, it didn't matter who you were, she would return a call. You know, to be careful with what you say, to have a forgiving heart. You know, I think that you know, she's completely open-minded. And for somebody who was so steeped in the past, she was so forward-looking. And I think that's really her legacy, is to be forward-looking.
I don't think we could have had a better benediction.
Amen.
This is, I think, been extraordinary. I think your mom would be thrilled from heaven to hear this. How many people loved her, cared about her, will always remember her. I think the panel did a great job. Thank you all very much.